I'm a grade 8 learner at Parktown Boys High School. On Wednesday morning, the 15th of January, at Parktown Boys, I saw a boy standing alone, looking lonely. My friend Solly and I went to him to introduce ourselves to him. His name was Enock Mpianzi. We instantly formed a bond. On the way to the bus, we greeted an older man who seemed to be Enock's father and introduced ourselves. There was no roll call done before we had stepped on the bus, and none was done before the first activity at Nyate River and Bush Lodge. We next had lunch. We were split into groups for the first activity, building a stretcher. I was in the same group as Enock. We were taken to a rugby field where we were given about 4 thick wooden poles and a few thinner poles and instructed to build a stretcher. We struggled tying the material together. Some poles kept on breaking. One of the activity facilitators told us to be more innovative and so to even use our shoelaces to tie the poles together. When the stretcher was complete, our next instruction was to race, carrying the stretcher, imagining an emergency. It had to be carried to the finish line. We were then told to take the stretcher to the river. There were no Parktown Boys High School teachers at the river, only us grade 8 boys, the school prefects, and the camp facilitators. The facilitators and prefects asked who could and could not swim, and those of us who said were able to swim were instructed to handle the river task. Enock identified himself as able to swim. No life vests were issued to any of us. None of us wore life vests. The school also had not asked us to bring any life vests to the camp. When we got to Crocodile River, we were told to get into the water and get ready to sail. Someone in the group was identified as the injured person for the purpose of the exercise and had to be sailed down the river, through the water, on the stretcher we had made, to a point along the river that was identified as Point B. We fitted a black rubber donut-like swimming tube under the stretcher. Again, no safety vests were provided to us. The river tides were strong. In less than 2 minutes in the water, the stretcher capsized. It came loose and we all scrapped for things to hang on to. Some of us held onto the rubber tube as it had become loose. Some of us used one arm to hang onto the rubber tube and the other to paddle. At that moment, I felt like I was going to die. Enock did not manage to get onto the rubber tube. I saw him struggling. He seemed stuck in one place, trying to keep his head above water. I grabbed a pole and tried to pass it to Enock, but I couldn't reach him. The river swept him away. Some boys started screaming for help as they saw, like me, Enock struggle, but there was no adult in sight. We were swept around the river bend and then I lost sight of Enock. At this point, by now a little further down the river from where we had started, we were grabbed by camp facilitators who had been waiting for us down the stream. The current was so strong that it was impossible to swim. We could all have been swept away. Some of us were likely to have been grabbed by the facilitators. While trying to catch our breaths, we were instructed to immediately walk to the hole using a thorny trail. Some of us pulled our tracksuit pants under our feet while walking on top of the thorns. There were no teachers at the river. I had last seen the teachers when we had arrived at the lodge. Roll call was done at the hole. Solly, my friend, raised his hand when Enoch's name was called. He was asked by the roll caller if he was Enock. When his response was no, the roll caller moved on to the next name. The person doing the roll call said he thinks Enock did not come to the camp. But I told him Enock was at the camp, and the last time I saw him, he was struggling in the river. The person then said there were groups with more head count and Enock might have left my group for another. My story about the river and Enock struggling was not listened to further. This was the very first roll call of the trip. For the next activity, we were meant to cook chicken for our supper. Our cooking was so bad that the camp provided full meals to us. I told my friend Solly how worried I was about not having seen Enock since the river. We then approached a camp facilitator to tell him that Enock was missing. The facilitator was rude and dismissed us. The second roll call was done in the evening around dinner time. Enock was still not there. When I asked the facilitator about Enock, again I was told that Enock was in another cabin and had left our group. I couldn't sleep that night. I kept hearing wild sounds and worried if Enock was alright. More activities happened following Thursday morning. One was an obstacle course and the other was swimming at the pool. In the morning on Thursday the 16th, a roll call was done and Enock was still not there. The teacher said he thinks Enock did not come to the camp. Sule and I went to the teacher and told him that Enock had definitely come to the camp and that the last time we saw him was at the river. It was after this that a search for Enock started. I then saw one facilitator go to the river with a life jacket to look for Enock. The camp activities continued, even though Enock was missing. After lunch, there was another roll call at the hall. Activities continued, including a trust fall, a plate activity, and a talk by Coach Luke. We then went to the pool. I came back, took a shower, and went to dinner. A woman facilitator called my group and showed us a photo of Enock and asked if we had seen him at the camp. Again, I said I had been with Enock. The facilitator took me and two other boys to another building. At this building, I was called to be interviewed by the police. Later on Friday, with the other boys, I boarded a bus back to Johannesburg. Before we left the lodge, the headmaster addressed us and emphasized that we must not speak to anyone. Later that day, I heard the news that my new friend was no longer alive.
For more, go to ewn.co.za.